Welcome back to another week. I'm so excited for you to join us on Let's Discuss with Meg Duke, where we discuss some things perinatal and all things mental health. This week, I am so excited. I have Nicole Arts. She's a licensed marriage and family therapist. She is the original snark for mental health professionals. She is the author of Sometimes Therapy is Awkward. Cannot wait to discuss that. Wearer of many hats, but she is the owner of the Psychotherapy Memes Instagram page. Welcome, 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 Nicole.
Yeah, I'm excited to be here. Thank you for having me.
It is such a pleasure. So I always start the conversation with how do we know each other? And the answer is I DM'd you.
My DMs. That's how we do it.
Right on in. But you were gracious enough to say yes. So thank you for being here. So what got you started? What was your like interest of like, I'm going to start an Instagram page and I'm going to talk about these things?
Yeah. It's funny. This is always the question I get asked. And at this point, like, I feel like I need to make a cooler cover story, but that would be inauthentic and that I'm not about that. So it's quite a like boring story. It was a couple years back. I was working a ton, you know, working the agency life, working the private practice life, hustling and grinding as so many of us therapists do, for better or worse. And
yes,
I just started making some memes and sharing them with coworkers because I was like, you know, our work is hard and we need like some real humor to get through it, right? And yeah, so I started putting them up on Instagram anonymously. And I at the time I didn't want my name associated with it. I thought it could like, you know, negatively impact my professional identity, which
sure.
was its own decision, if you will, in coming forward with my name and all that. But yeah, so I started making memes and talking about our field and poking some fun at who we are as therapists and like the daily struggles we endure. And it just like grew its legs. And that's the story. It's become this really cool community, this really supportive space where, you know, we have mental health professionals all over the world connecting and commiserating, and a good amount of clients too, who learn about how therapy works and get a little bit more of a human side as to what the process looks like. There's such a like mystique taboo about therapy, and some of that's probably legitimate, but some of it can be stigmatizing. And so it's a way to ideally create more fluid conversation about the field. So that's the long-winded answer to what you asked.
Yes, and it's so funny. And one of the things that I saw when I saw your account, I was like, yes, I'm so glad somebody created this, because I do have to admit, like, I've had these like backroom conversations before of like, we should talk about this is so funny, da da da. But also like, if we can be honest, we're human and sometimes our jobs are stressful and sometimes we need to make jokes about the stressful and sometimes wild things that some people bring to us. And sometimes they're not like, I definitely wouldn't, they're not like the most clinical. Sometimes we just need to joke. And so it's nice to be able to see stuff like this where it's like, let's just not take ourselves too seriously. Clients, if you want to read it, fine, but don't take it personally. Like, we're just all humans trying to make it through.
Yeah, we're all humans trying to like connect with the other humans, grow. And like, and one thing I've learned is so many of us therapists just have very shared feelings. And we have a lot of shared experiences, which is really interesting because we specialize in so many different things and work from so many different models. But yet you cut that down and like we all kind of relate to some of these very core themes of, you know what I mean? Like shame and vulnerability and like work-life balance and our personal relationships and boundaries. Like these are human issues that impact all of us. So
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I love it too, because I really do feel like, so I'm a social worker. And so social work, you think law and order, you think baby snatching CPS. Like that's not, believe me, obviously there's so much more to it, but like you see the colloquial side, like the Hollywood side of social work, of therapy broadly. You see people lying on a couch with their back to their therapist, whatever it might be. I loved your post from, I think it was even like yesterday, where it was like the SNL sketch of like this person looking around like, why am I even here in family therapy? And it's like, I saw that and I was like, oh my gosh, so relatable. Yes. So it's kind of helpful to be like,
I'll work with those families or those clients that are like, why am I here? What's the point of this? This is a waste of my time, waste of my money.
Yes.
And it's never to poke fun at those people. Like, I don't believe I don't actually agree with like meme accounts that target people who seek services. We never want to shame that. But just
No
drawing on like
shame.
this collective human experience of like ambivalence and fear of change and like these, like
Yes.
I said, universal experiences of like what going to therapy and like working on yourself really means. Like it's hard. It's super hard. It's hard as a therapist, it's hard as the client. I truly believe good therapists have experience of being clients themselves. And so
Yes.
we know what that feels like on both sides of the metaphorical couch, right? So
Yes. And that, 'cause that's what I saw. I keep having this conversation both personally and professionally about like, I just feel like culturally in the world today, we're a very defensive space of like, I'm not doing anything wrong. Clearly, it's your problem. So when I saw that meme, and again, there are many ways you can interpret that, but I was just like, yeah, that is a lot of times where people are like, why am I here? What am I doing? And I love that you mentioned that. There is zero shame. Like, we're all here to learn. We're all here to, we want to change in some way, or we want some aspect of our lives to be different. And so,
yes.
how can we be vulnerable and be open and feel like sharing in a way that makes us feel comfortable? And hey, heaven forbid, maybe even have a little bit of a humor, sense of humor about it, right?
Yeah, it's something that I feel like as we can tap into those parts of ourselves, it relaxes us, it connects us to other people. And yeah, like with you said with the humor part, like I do use humor in my work, I use humor in my life. And not as like concentrated as I would on a meme page, but I do believe humor is its own language, its own ability to say like, hey, like life is so serious and I see that, but there's also a time and place to like laugh at some of the bullshit that we deal with as humans, as whoever we are. I mean, as mothers, as wives, as partners, as kids, like all of it, whatever role we take on, there's some shit to laugh about and cry about. And we got to know when the right time is for that kind of stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh my gosh. What has your experience been with like with social media, with followers, with comments? What has it been like for you? How do you help? How do you sort it all? Just generally, what are people saying, I guess, and then kind of going from there.
It's quite interesting, the meme page, because those people who know me know like I'm pretty actually private in real life and I don't use social media like much at all. I do have
Yeah.
it, but I don't use it a lot in the way that it would look like I might, you know,
Right.
beyond the meme page. And so I am always really cognizant of whatever I share on there could be read by past clients, current clients, future clients. And so like, to me, it's like if I'm posting that, it's always with the assumption that like a follower could be a client of mine, or what have you. And so that's always like the forefront of my mind. And to be honest, the feedback's been mostly positive. I'd say like a good 90 to 95% of the fans are like super
Wow.
loyal and supportive and wonderful. There's always, you know, the hate mail that's gonna come through, but such is life. And
Yeah.
sometimes that feedback's useful too. Like sometimes it makes me reflect on how my message may come across, or was something a little too rude, because sometimes that happens. And you know, I never want to come across as like harming people, you
Yeah.
know. Therapists, it's always like a consideration we have to have, like whether we like it or not, our identity on social media reflects who we are as therapists, or at least clients can put that on us. And so we need to be mindful of our public images, and that's why yeah, like I said, I always kind of consider that as the template for what I'm going to share with.
I know I have to tell you, there have been some times where I'm like, silly HIPAA, if only I could share this, but not just because of HIPAA do I not share my clients' information, but sometimes I'm like, oh, there was something so beautiful or so, but it was a very specific thing to a client. And I'm like, well, I can't share that wisdom with anybody because that's that client's wisdom.
Ask me like, what was the best client you have, or was the most profound moment? And like, those questions could never be answered, you know, at least not truthfully, because above everything, like I value my client's safety and confidentiality, above anything I could post on social media. And it's actually a scary reality, because I do see a lot of therapists kind of pushing that envelope. And I don't want to say anybody's doing like an unethical job, but it's just something to be mindful of. Like, I would never want to come across a therapist I've worked with using material that I know we talked about in session, and like just seeing that on a public page, that would be very unnerving for me. So, you know, I think about what that would feel like if a client comes across their therapist presenting themselves in such a way and how that might feel or impact their relationship.
Yeah, it is. You're absolutely correct. It's very tough to be able to, when somebody asks, or like, I teach over at the University of Kansas. And so that is like there's an expectation of privacy in that classroom where they're able to
Sure.
staff their cases and we're able to do that. But even still, I am like, I still have that like moment of, oh, I'm standing in front of a classroom talking about something. And sometimes I'll kind of give an amalgam of a situation versus a very specific information. But yeah, absolutely. And I have that in my disclaimers too on my Instagram page. Like, you're welcome and encouraged to be here, but I won't be commenting. I won't be responding to you. If you whatever you put on here is you acknowledging that this is not private. So, and luckily none of my cl some of my clients do follow me because I'll see them like stuff and I'll recognize their name, but
Yeah.
none of them have ever, knock on wood, none of them yet have ever been like, oh, Meg's my therapist and she says this to me and it
I don't know if I've ever, to be honest, I don't monitor everything super intensely. Like I know some people will like filter out comments or delete comments. I don't. I unless something's like spam for the most part and it's obvious
yeah.
spam, I just happen to see it. I just kind of let the chips fall where may they.
Yes.
I'm
Yes.
having mom brain and can't say that phrase. Have the chips fall where they
Where
do
they
not.
may or where they
Yeah,
lie.
I think
Let the
that's what
chips
it is.
fall where they lie. I'm telling, it is
Now that I'm
Friday.
thinking about it, I can't remember how to say it, but if I were to say it organically, it'd come. But you know what
That's
I
exactly right.
mean.
That's how it works, where it's like I just had it in my brain and then I got to the end of the sentence and then my brain stopped working.
Yes. But what I was going to say is, we're all adults. I mean, if you're a child, you really shouldn't be using social media, but we are all adults and we're all capable of hopefully like being able to filter and sift through commentary and feedback and have hopefully mature discussions about that. So not everybody's going to agree with one another. Yeah, I don't think I've, and now that I think of it, I can't remember a single time a client's been like, oh, hey, Nicole, it's me. I don't
Yeah. Well, and I
know.
will say, if I may humbly say or respectfully say, you have 120,000 followers more than I do. So I think it's probably a little easier for me to be like, oh, I see that, so
Right,
and so.
that could definitely be. Yes,
Look,
there's.
I put it, it's all good. But yeah, I was like, oh, you have like $140,000. I would hope that you're not going through and looking at 7,500 likes and being like, is anybody, do I know anybody? That would be.
No, I do try and get through the inbox. Like, no, I can't get to all of it. That's just unrealistic, and I don't feel right like outsourcing it. It is my page. I keep it to myself and
Yeah,
my husband.
yeah.
But yeah, for the most part, the fans have like the followers have brought me such opportunity and ability to connect with other therapists and with platforms and launching my book, supporting the products and services that I've created. So I like to give back and communicate with the people who have kind of been there for me since the beginning. And like I said, most everybody on there has been so awesome and just supportive and positive. Like it makes me have so much hope in our field, which is exciting.
Yeah, that's really great to hear. I love it with some hope. I know our field is very stressful
We are
and
stressed right now. We are
there's so much
horribly stressed.
stress. There's so much sad and negative and there's a lot of helpless and hopeless sometimes and sometimes I've heard the expression and often use it of like I'm somebody as the therapist I'm kind of like their chamois, like I kind of collect all that, but then also I need to go to my therapist and be wrung out sometimes because it's just like I'm happy to take that. I'm happy to try to, sit through that and hold that space. And then it can be a lot to try to just, to compartmentalize and maybe not be able to sometimes. So it's nice to be able to have spaces like this where we're able to, appropriately discuss with fellow therapists. This is obviously not an appropriate place for us to staff cases,
Yeah.
but in your clinical supervision groups or whatever you might have, where you can just feel really, validated and kind of use that space. It's nice to get that hope, to see some more of that hope come back too.
Yeah, we are, oh man, we're so hungry for hope, I think, in this field and just in life right now, a lot of us. And so that's a whole other discussion though. But yeah, it's been good. It's been really good, and I'm grateful for what I have.
I'm glad to hear that. So I have a tangent.
Yeah,
You
let's do it.
mentioned children and social media, and you are welcome to be like, Meg, I did not prepare for this, so I am not gonna, I don't have an answer. But
Totally.
was it yesterday that the Surgeon General suggested that we not have like children under 13 is not old enough for social media. Did you see that?
I don't know. I didn't see it, but I don't disagree. You know,
I saw it and I was like, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah. I mean, truthfully, like, I have such mixed feelings about social media. I truly think it's one of the worst things that's ever happened, like, in modern society.
Yeah.
Yet, there's always a yet.
Yeah.
It connects people. There's validation. There's I'm not alone. There's I can talk to anyone at a given moment. And that can be really affirming for so many people. But so it's a tool. It's not good or bad. It can just be used in really dramatically good or really dramatically bad ways. And with kids, they just don't have the same level of critical thinking that adults, even adults, we don't have all
and
that.
And adults don't either, but yes.
And just the ability to get sucked in and like compulsively use these platforms. And, you know, I think about like, for better or worse, what I was doing online at like 13 or 14. And like, this was before like even smartphones. This is when you gotta like log in on your family computer. And like, none
bing
of it
bong,
was
bing
good.
Bong, bing bong.
Yeah, like none of what I was doing was great, to be honest. And so thinking about how much access kids have and, oh man, it's a little scary, but it's not slowing down either. So there has to be conversations about like harm reduction and teaching these things safely to young kids. And, you know, as we know, abstinence itself doesn't usually work. So in most mediums in life. And so how do we integrate these things that we have in our society and have helped people build hopefully healthier relationships with them? I don't know. I don't have the answers. I have kids myself. They're young. The idea of them being on social media is very scary. So get back to me in a decade and we'll see what my
Hello.
Thoughts are.
Hello. Literally, I was just going to say, it was like, I'm very selfish about my kids, my timeline of children. And listeners of the show, everyone who's new, welcome. Those of you who've been here before know, like, I have my own struggles with fertility, but it's interesting of like, to think about my first pregnancy and what age that child would be versus the children who I'm lucky to have. And it's like the pandemic and quarantine, like I didn't have to worry about homeschooling. I mean, I stayed home with my son for 4 months when we moved here, but like he was 8 months old. So not the same as having a third grader and trying to teach whatever.
I resonate. We must have kids very close in age. Mine was 4 months old. So like,
at the
time it felt catastrophic, but I'm like, oh my God, I'm not mitigating like, homeschooling and working and like a kid who can't see his friends and all of the nuances of that, which can be like a 20-hour discussion that we don't need to have. But
But that's literally that. I think of that like touch point, and then I think of this conversation that popped up yesterday, and I'm like, good. So y'all will have that figured out by the time my kids get to be 13, right? Not that people can't.
I'm so really- with you. It's kind of like, can we get the self-driving cars going? Because the idea of teaching my kids how to drive brings me an anxiety that like, I don't know if I've ever known. And I know that sounds really dramatic and clearly speaks to some anxiety that I should probably work on, but I have a long time and I'm like, we'll have that figured out hopefully by the time they're trying.
I'm so selfish in my thinking of like, but y'all will like really figure that out. Right. And then I'll be able to make my own parenting choices individually, but based on some more longitudinal interventions or ideas.
Selfish because like we are probably wired to care about like our own offspring and families more than we would care about a stranger's per se. But like I also think it speaks to risk and us knowing how the world works and us wanting what's best for people, you know, like this is not just about what you want for your kids, it's kids universe, like we all care about the children, we all care about a safe environment, you know.
Yes.
and we see ramifications, so
yes.
Yeah, but I relate completely to what you're saying.
Yeah, I know that like I'm on social media a lot. Obviously, your page is a lot of attraction for you. And so when I saw that yesterday, I was like, ooh, I might bring that up. So I'm glad that you were able to kind of roll with me on that randomness. But yeah, that is definitely something. Because again, the parents don't necessarily, the adults don't necessarily have the wherewithal to understand sometimes. And therefore also we can't expect tiny babies to be able to so much. So anyway, but that's so exciting to see that psychotherapy means I can't tell you myself. That's why I reached out. I was like, the validation that I see. Page so much. So tell me about what was it that made you decide to start Soul of Therapy? And if you could tell a little bit everyone about Soul of Therapy who may not know.
Oh yeah, Soul of Therapy is a really it's old at this point. It's my one of my first businesses that I my first business endeavors, I guess I'll call it. So Soul of Therapy is my media, SEO, content writing business for therapists. Not just therapists, but any mental health professional, but most of us mostly therapists.
Yeah.
So I make it no secret that when I was in graduate school, I needed money. And so I learned that I could sell writing for money. And, you know, that was really amazing and validating. I've always loved writing. It's something I've always been extremely passionate about, and I've really worked to kind of refine my skill and learn as much as I can about it. And so, yeah, that's kind of the birth story of that. So, you know, now it's a company that helps therapists with their online presences. You know, we do like a lot of back end search engine optimization, like branding strategies. A lot of therapists who are like in their growth phases. So like they're jumping into private practice, they're building a group practice, they're getting involved with like community outreach. They need like more like large scale advertising. And so, the reason I'm passionate about it is because you can hire any writer to do anything, but there's something that we've noticed is very like intimate about hiring a therapist to do your writing.
Sure.
Because if you're writing about like, say, coping with self-harm or coping with trauma, like that is so vulnerable and so intimate. And yes, like a good writer could research that and write about it, but there's always that risk that it could come across as a little sterile, a little inauthentic, a little like, do you really know the nuances of like self-harm and like suicidal thoughts and feeling alone and feeling like nobody understands you and feel, you know? And so that's my goal with the writing is that, you know, as a therapist, I think I get it for the most part because I do the work all day. And so being able to kind of carry that out in the writing projects that I do, both for myself and for the clients that my company works for. So yeah, that's my professional side of things.
Good. Yeah. Well, that's really fun. I just thought that was such an interesting thing and such a needed thing. And I can't tell you how many people I get emails from, like marketing, SEO, PR, people reaching out of like, oh, we want to help you to get into people's magazines or whatever. And I'm like, but like, I don't feel like you know what I do.
So. And a lot of that's spam. So just letting you know.
Oh, like for sure. Oh, it goes in, yeah, it goes into like, spam. But I just, totally. I have thought about that before of even the people who, yeah, for sure. I never.
A lot of therapists really get hung up on talking about themselves and really struggle to define their practice. And so that's, I would say the bulk of my work is brainstorming with therapists and saying like, let's talk about who you are, because when they're face to face with a client, they can do the work. But then if they're asked to say, like, talk to me about your practice, they're like, I work with depression, but like, wait, you know, like some,
there's so much more than you do than that.
Yeah. And marketing is important, like, especially in modern times where most clients are turning online to look for a therapist. And if, you know, you want to stand out and you're working in a more saturated area, it is important to have good online visibility. And so, yeah, that's what our company does. And I do a lot of writing for like nonprofits and grants and just companies trying to raise awareness for mental health advocacy, which is always going to be a passion of mine. It's very near and dear to my heart. So yeah.
That is amazing. Yeah. I love that. It's so great to hear. So I'm glad that that exists in this world. And then the other thing that I really want to talk about is, you mentioned already your book, Sometimes Therapy is Awkward. Now, if I may fangirl just a little bit before we go into this even more, I actually do supervision groups for LMSW seeking their clinical licensure. And I had one of them a while ago suggest this book to me. And it was so funny because I saw psychotherapy memes and I knew Sometimes Therapy was Awkward. And I never really made that connection. And so then I was talking to my supervisees a couple weeks ago and I'm like, oh, I'm having her on my show. And they were like, you what? It wasn't required course reading for my supervision group, but we've definitely talked about it a lot. So I just wanted to have a little fangirl moment for Meg's
That's
supervision.
so sweet. That's so sweet. Well, thank you all, whoever's listening.
Yes. Oh, and they will be listening for sure.
Well, people have said that. They're like, I recognize the book, and then I follow the meme page, and then they're like, holy shit, it's all the same person. And that's kind of cool. Like, I'm kind of grateful for that, because I love my meme page. It is truly, wholeheartedly, authentically me. But there is like a very existential, serious, like creative side of me that I know can't necessarily come through with the memes. That's very passionate about like the work of therapy. And so I'm glad that people can relate to the book without it just being like all straight snark and humor, although some of that's infused in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's awesome. Thank you for sharing that story with me.
Yeah, absolutely. So tell me, like, what sparked the idea? I guess maybe like, what came first, the chicken or the egg? Did you have an idea of like, I'm going to write a book and it's going to be called Sometimes Therapy is Awkward? Did you start with the idea of writing a book and you were like, oh, this is the perfect encapsulation of it? Like, what was that process looking like for you?
So I've always known in like my heart of hearts, I wanted to write a book. I was going to write a book. It was going to happen. Just didn't know when or what it would be about. And I always assumed it was going to be fiction. So life has interesting plans. And
hey.
it was kind of a merging of a lot of things. So with all these writing assignments and writing work that I've done with my company, you know, just learning a lot about therapy, learning a lot about the work that we do, sitting with clients all day and like knowing what that feels like. And then the third branch on my tree being this meme page and learning so much about these like shared experiences and these like vulnerable moments that weren't really getting captured in psychotherapy text, at least not in a modern kind of fresh way. You know, a lot of the text that we read reads is so like, here, let me talk at you about how therapy works, you know,
yes.
instead of like, let's talk with you about how therapy can work. Not to dismiss like the master books. I love them. I read them. I'm an avid reader. These books are important, but I've always felt like something was missing, you know, just kind of this like validating, reassuring piece, like, hey, you got this. And there's going to be some hard, awkward parts, but like you're capable of getting through this. And it's going to be really rewarding. It's just going to be a little weird at times. So kind of holding all those feelings. So, I just, how my writing process works, I just start writing a bunch of ideas, knowing it doesn't really have shape yet. And I'm working on my second book right now and the same thing's happening where finally I got like, okay, now the structure's here, but it takes a while till the structure really forms. And so it's kind of this trust process of like, okay, as long as I keep getting ideas on paper, at some point I'll be able to thread them. It's not a perfect process. And I tell people all the time, like, I refuse to read my first book, like, at all, because when I do, I'm like, oh my gosh, there's so many mistakes. Why did I write that? Why didn't I add that? You know, and I think that's normal for most artists. Like, I hear a lot of actors, like, won't watch their movies.
Won't watch their films.
I don't know if you'll listen to your podcast recordings after. You probably feel, like, annoyed sometimes when you do, you know, like, things like that, where you're just like, why did I say that? Or why, you know? And I'm not overly self-critical on it, but there's that piece of, like, you know, we're our own harshest critics, but
yes.
Yeah. And then COVID hit. And so I was like, you know, let's just do this. Let's just bang this out. I'm home with my 4-month-old. Not that that was easy, but something sparked the desire to write and write and write. And, yeah, that's kind of how it took shape. The title has actually changed at the very last minute. So, I had a beta reader. I had several beta readers, but my original title was something along the lines of Reassurance for the Growing Therapist. And I remember he's like, I love the book. I have a few light edits, but everything's great. But like, he's like, I can't get behind the title. Like it's too generic. It doesn't speak to the freshness of the book. And I was like, I don't know. I was telling my husband this. I was like, I don't know. Like sometimes therapy's just awkward. I was like, there it is. Like, there's the fucking title. So,
and that's what I'm going to call this book.
And there we go. And I was like, can that be the title? And he's like, I think so. And I was like, let's do it. And so, sometimes therapy's awkward, man. Like sometimes it's awkward and
yeah,
I'm going to stick with that.
It's, but it, okay, if I may, not being a beta reader or a book editor or in publishing of any kind, although actually my husband and I have written a couple children's books, and so maybe I might sneak back into your DMs
Oh,
one day and see about how
cool.
to get to, but anyway, another story for another day. But yeah, it's so interesting because you're talking about like reassurance for the therapist, and like that's such a meaningful thing, and the content obviously would have been the same either way, but the idea of like the catchiness of sometimes therapy is awkward. It's so blunt and to the point of like, and that's it. And keep reading this, and like, and then read this book about it. Yeah, so I'm glad that you were able to have that conversation with your husband and be like, oh hey, I'm just gonna call it that. It's gonna be perfect.
Yeah, it was it's very interesting how titles are. And you know, I look at my bookshelf and I look at a lot of the therapy books, and like there are so many talented therapist writers, but I don't know what it is. Like they do not practice their creativity with the titles. Like they're so dull and so boring. And I guess it
Yes,
doesn't really
yes, yes.
matter, but you
Yeah.
know, I was kind of like, this isn't reflective of me or what I'm writing. And so you know,
Yeah.
and I was with the cover designer, I was like, we're gonna make it bright yellow. We're gonna like make this thing pop, you know, because it's reflective of like, I think how a lot of newer therapists feel. Like I'm bringing my full personality to the room. I'm trying to bring some life into therapy, you know. But yeah, it's a wild ride.
Yeah, for sure. That's, I mean, that's just so great and wonderful to hear. And I love that too. So you, what you're kind of saying is like the empty page is the fear of the writer of like, I want to make sure if I've got something written down, then I can do something with it versus just like nothing. So I'm just gonna put down some stuff and put down some stuff and kind of merge it and blend it and order it how I see fit kind of down the road.
Yeah, like I don't know if you've ever done a collage. I'm sure you have, because I think everybody in the world's done a collage. You get
Sure.
like a bunch of magazine pictures, you get a bunch of whatever, and you don't paste them right away. You like gather them all and you're like, okay, let me see what I have available to me, and then I'll
Yes.
start putting them in the places that seem fit, or okay, I'll realize this one's too big, I need to cut it a little more, or I need to add
Sure.
some more. And then after you look at it and you're like, this still probably isn't perfect, but I got what I, you know, this is good enough for
Yeah.
now. And there's that acceptance piece that needs to come into play. And so not everybody has the same process with writing a book. I am friends with several different authors, and everybody kind of has their own unique process. And mine probably will evolve over time, just as therapy styles evolve and we evolve as people. But yeah, for now it's kind of this chaotic, like dumping of ideas and information and quotes and research and things that seem interesting. And then I have like 1,000 tabs open at a given time. And then hopefully
My
like,
ADHD brain can relate to
what is it? Like, I swear, like, do people ever work on one tab? Like, I'd love to know you and interview you.
Wait, I say, if you are listening, DM me, DM Nicole. We'll have you on this show together.
You're a
We
one
want to
tab
interview you.
professional.
I not only have, I mean, I got to tell you why, if you don't mind a quick tangent, I have multiple tabs open, and obviously I have multiples open for our conversation
Yeah.
today, but like I have three different Microsoft Edge tabs open. I have Firefox for University of Kansas. I have Google Chrome for another CBT program that I work on. Like that's how I'm able to
And
keep
how many
my full
screens are you on?
one.
Oh, okay. So you need to get the monitors.
I need monitors. I will absolutely acknowledge that that would be very nice because I also do all of my tax documents in an Excel file, and just generally I would love to have like a big
More
pretty.
monitors equals more tabs, because
Oh, maybe my ADHD can't handle
it's like how you
it.
have more more rooms in a house, more stuff to put in them. So
Yes.
like it's pure chaos,
That
but
is it. Yes. Yeah.
okay.
Okay, so I have to ask you, which in your Etsy store, which is your favorite, which is of your favorite mugs? I know it's like maybe having to pick between your favorite children, but which is your favorite?
Probably this one that I'm actually drinking out of, and this wasn't intentional. I wasn't, but this
Not
one,
at all.
it's actually not the snarky one. It just says running on coffee, compassion, and existential crises. And because I just feel like if I had a motto, that would be me. Like I am running on coffee 9 times out of 10, compassion, and existential crises. And like that is the core of who I am. And so I think that's actually relates to a lot of, although some therapists drink tea, but
Well, I was gonna say, as I sit here drinking tea, yes, but otherwise.
right. We tend to be a little bit polarized in what our preferred beverage of choice is, but I think most of us can relate to that. So I don't
I
know.
love that. I was like, if you don't mind me again being a little bit of a fangirl, I really love that my therapist thinks you're great. Because when I first read that, I was like, oh, that's, you know how like we make the jokes about mom, like, well, that just earned me another 3 years on the couch or whatever sort
Right.
of thing. But I was like, well, that's nice though. I don't, we don't often think, we think of it in a snarky way, but like, and also there are people who come into sessions and they talk about people who are supportive and lovely and they are their safe place and they are their grounding or they whatever it might be. And I'm like, yeah, I guess there are people who probably very much could say like, my therapist thinks you're great and that would be accurate. And I was like,
It's a
totally
little
accurate.
meta, like in my head, it's a little meta, but yeah, totally. It's like something you could give like your partner because it's like, yeah, my therapist thinks you're great. And it's like, I think you're good. Like, you're a great person. Because if a therapist thinks you're great, you're probably like bona fide great, you know, because we're harsh critics and we're
Yes.
skeptical. You see so many like horrible relationships and cycles of abuse and manipulation and gaslight. I don't need to get into all the logistics, but we tend to be a little hard with that kind of stuff because we know the damage that, you know, these unhealthy relationships can bring to our clients. And so, yeah,
Yeah.
that one actually, yeah, that one doesn't get a lot of traction. It could be a little too meta, but
I was gonna say meta
I.
would be a very appropriate way of looking at it, but I just, it's the one that stopped and made me think of like, I wasn't expecting that to be available. I was expecting it to be like, you're the reason my therapist says I'm in therapy, right?
Right. And I've seen mugs like that, and like there's truth behind it. To me, I'm like, oh man, that's it's so interesting what in my head feels mean, because a lot of
Yes.
people could construe as what I say is mean, and maybe it is, but to me that was like, man, that one always seems a little mean, like
For sure. For sure. First of all, I'm a therapist and I'm biased. I do believe, first of all, acknowledging the United States that there is a disparity of access to mental health services and other
yeah.
things, but I believe generally all other things being equal that everyone would benefit from a therapist in some form or fashion. But blaming somebody for the reason you had to go to therapy, and it's funny because a couple of clients just popped into my mind of like, yeah, that's the reason that person came to therapy, and that's the reason that person. Anyway, yeah. See, it's a little, it's a tad aggressive. But the other one I wanted to mention was that it was that if I could read minds, I would be a billionaire, not a therapist. And I actually say that a lot in supervision. Not that exact expression. What I say is, if we knew the best thing for everyone to do in their lives, like if we were omniscient or we could tell, we I would live on a yacht in Mallorca with Beyonce. I would not be living in Lanai,
Absolutely. I mean, I
Kansas.
would literally be a billionaire. I'd know what companies to invest in. I'd know, I mean, imagine the power you could harness. But yeah, and it's not a gift we want to have. Like, you don't want to go through life reading minds. Like, imagine the pain of that, you
No,
know?
no, no.
We don't know what's best for everybody, because even what object there's no objective best. Like, you have to consider
No.
values and culture and preference and a bajillion things. Like, what's best for me is not like would be probably awful for you or for someone else. You know, we all have our different ideas of a perfect life, and we should never come across as assuming we know what's best for our clients. Now, there's some suggestions that tend to be healthier in nature than others. You know, like there's certain coping skills that most people can universally agree with. Like, yeah, that's probably more adaptive than this coping skill. But, you know, our clients drive their own cars of their own lives. We are lucky to sit in their passenger seat for a brief period in their
Yes.
life.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, thank you for that. Because again, like if you are going to therapy and you are looking for somebody to tell you what to do, first of all, if that person is telling you what to do, I would question that. And
Yes.
second of all, reassess the goal. What are you looking for is maybe to making changes or whatever. But if you're looking for me to just be like, hi, I'm Meg Duke and I know everything. And here's what you can do. Here's a checklist and go. Like,
Then you might as well be in a cult, you know, not to be dramatic, like you might as well be in a cult, like, or be a child and have your parent tell you what to do and you get mad about it. You know, good therapy is never about saying you should do this. It's we present options, we explore, we,
ask questions.
yeah, there's so much
Yeah.
to it. I mean, yeah, so if you are listening to this and you're looking for a therapist to just tell you what to do, you're not looking for a therapist.
No,
At least
no.
not one that I would trust.
You're looking for a good Judy to give you advice. And again, I don't know if anybody, you are the only person who has 100% of the information. So.
And here's the thing about advice. Like I always tell people, there's no shortage of it. You can find advice anywhere. You can, AI can give you advice at this point, you know, like that's the conversation lately. So
that's
just,
true.
just throw that into AI. They can tell you what to do. That doesn't mean we're going to do it. Like nine times out of 10, we know the thing we want to do. Therapy is about, well, why aren't you doing it? What's really getting in the way? What's scaring you? What's stopping you? What's X, Y, Z, you know?
Right. And I have to be honest too. Why I did where the way we started the conversation was like, I love psychotherapy memes because it really does say things that I want to say. And I appreciate where you were like, I almost didn't want to put my name on it, but like, now I'm glad I did. And like, and I'm saying, I'm acknowledging, especially when you work like in a group practice or a psych hospital or something where sometimes you'll go into the office and just be like, this is making me so upset or frustrated or whatever. And like, these are not things clients would want us to hear, but like, I have to be honest, like, generally speaking, I don't even have an opinion. I'm just asking, like, even if you're thinking like, okay, but if you were my friend, what would you like? Of course, my brain doesn't work that way anymore because I've been doing therapies for so long. But like a client will come to me and if they'll say like, should I get a divorce or not? I'm like, I literally don't know. I literally like even Meg, your good Judy sitting at the bar would not say like, yeah, you should get a divorce. No, you should stay with that person. I really don't know. Like, I'm just going to keep asking you questions. So again, kind of this is my little PSA of people seeking therapy, like, tis awkward, and we don't have all the information, lest we would be billionaires living on a yacht in Mallorca with Beyonce.
We are lucky and privileged to get 50 to 55-ish minutes of your week, you know, and I remember reading how many thoughts we go through a day now, I can't remember, but it's lots, like it's a million.
It's mind-blowing how many
thoughts. And so you're sharing a small fraction of that with your therapist, and that's going through its own filters, that's going through its own analysis and a lot of other factors that are complex to talk about. But all is to say, yeah, like we therapists do not sit here being like, yes, this client should do that or they should not do that, because life is so nuanced and it's the subjectivity is limitless. And so
that's so true. And I will say something you just said that made me think about, like, one of my favorite psychiatrists I work with said, the two people you never lie to are your lawyer and your therapist or your doctor. He said doctor because he's a psychiatrist, but your lawyer and your therapist. And it's like, and I do encourage people of that. Like, if we are doing work based on a lie, then we are wasting our time. If we are doing work based on the way that you are viewing the situation or your interpretation of it, then of course we can do the work there. So I do encourage people of, like, because you mentioned like how things come through filters and go through, like, being able to get in a space where you can find a therapist, where you can feel like you can be your most honest and authentic self is a great place to be. But again, yeah, we are focused. Like you said, you get 45 minutes with me once a week talking about it was literally like a million thoughts a day or something like that seemed impossible.
And I feel like I run through a million thoughts before 9 a.m. Like, you know, that number even seems low. I do want to like add one little disclaimer on that, just because I always feel like this is important for clients who are listening. Like, if you have lied or do lie to your therapist, like, I want to normalize that. That's a very common experience.
And oh, sure.
Thank you
for saying that.
Discrediting you. I think people come with so much shame for that. And like, it's very normal. It's scary to open up to a stranger, and like, trust can take time, especially when the therapy relationship is new. And so if you're listening to this and you're like, I know I need to get to a more truthful place, like, it's okay. And you can even talk about those fears with your therapist, and a good therapist will sit with you and for you, because like, honesty is a weird thing. And there's reasons that we hold information tight to us. You know, so many of us are afraid of being rejected or being abandoned.
Vulnerable.
And being vulnerable. And so,
I appreciate you saying that, because I feel like mine is like a quick quip side of a coffee mug thing. Like, only two people you don't lie to. But I do agree that it's like, it's not hi, this is our introductory 15-minute Zoom call, and I'm going to be the most honest and never lie or never, not that, but the goal can be to be in an open space and being honest and recognizing like, I'm not quite ready to get there, and that's okay, or I'm not ready to share that. Yes, I appreciate you taking a step back from my quippiness to like really dig into that a little more for sure.
It's just a topic that like I'm personally passionate about in my therapy practice with clients because, and it could be like the style of therapy I do. I just it's so common to like have that resistance and that fear and that like the lying, really. Like it's normal. And we want to dig into like what's
Yeah.
happening, what are the fears and what messages are you telling yourself and what defense mechanisms are you holding on to? Because I think people then sometimes feel guilty. They're like, like I'm supposed to be being honest. I'm not. Are they going to be mad at me? Are they going to dump me? Are they going to, all these like
Yeah.
catastrophic messages that come through. So,
I can't imagine. I'm sure, I don't want to say never, never say never. Very rarely is any one thing all just one thing. I really can't imagine me being wanting to fire a client because they weren't honest. If we're talking about it in a way that's like, let's process,
yeah.
let's talk about how you came to a space where you were wanting to be not telling me the truth, and now you're here and you are like,
Agree. It's
talk through
beautiful.
all of that. Absolutely. Yeah.
Speaks to the relationship, which is such a an
Yeah.
intimate relationship that's quite unlike anything else that we have in this life. So
Yeah. Well, it has been such a pleasure. I cannot thank you enough for opening my little DM. So before we get going, where can the team find you?
yeah, so I'm lurking everywhere. I mean, you can best find me on Instagram at psychotherapy memes, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, not TikTok. We'll see about that.
Same.
I'm on you can find me at nicolearts.com. My book is pretty much sold anywhere books are sold, and I'm also at soulofthherapy.com for my writing and professional content services. So if you want to reach out, I tend to be pretty friendly, so feel free to contact me if any needs come up.
Great, amazing. Thank you again for the time. What a pleasure it has been. And for everyone else out there, be curious, not judgmental. Goodbye.